After replacing the exterior walls and the wall partitions, now it's time to look at the roof. In this project, we have three units of the building, Unit A, B, C. Unit B has a much higher roof, and Unit A and C is going to have a similar roof. So in this case, we're going to replace the roof three times. However, those roofs have the same exact assembly, so we can just customize one roof types and utilize that across the whole project. So let's take a look at the plan grid joints and try to examine the details of the roof. So let's go to page A3.3. You'll find it was a roof detail, and actually show you what's going to happen when you elevation change between unit A and B or B and C. So obviously in this case, on the left side, this is going to be unit B, which is taller, and on the right hand is going to be unit C or A. Okay, in this case, it's actually going to be unit C. Now, here, the roof meets, okay, the two roofs meet with each other through this vertical portion of the roof, which you have a metal studs as the frame, and it have sheathing as well as the blocking and the insulation, as well as the membrane around it. So through this joint, through this detail view, you realize that the roof consists of three different components. First thing is the metal decking. That's a structural component of the roof, which is 1.5 inch according to previous structural framing detail. Then you have a 3 inch, okay, rigid insulation, and then you have a 45 mil white TPO membrane. And TPO membrane is very commonly used in single ply roof system. So in this case, we understand that what the components of the roof is, and now what we need to figure out is actually the placement dimension. In this project, I'm not going to ask you to place this vertical portion of the roof. It gets getting a little bit too excessive. What I'm going to ask you to do is actually model your roof at the top all the way till the edge of that right flange bin. Okay, so unit B, the roof will be modeled all the way to the edge of the wide flange beam. Then for unit A and C, we're going to model the roof all the way against the wave of the wide flange beam, which is also the grid line 5 or 8. Okay, so this is grid line 5 or 8, depends on which unit you're at. Okay, so in that case, we have already known the types of the roof and we know where to model to. We still need some more dimensions before you can actually start modeling aspects. Now, let's go to one of the section views, such as the A3.0. Here, you can see where does the roof stop at the front. Okay, so you see, examine this little detail view here, right above the storefront, you see the roof actually goes all the way against, okay, all the way against that metal studs, which is a 6 inch beyond, okay, 6 inch beyond that grid line A. And also the elevation of the front roof is going to be 16 foot 4 inches, okay? That's at unit A or C. For unit B, it's going to be different. It's going to be 16 foot 9 inches top of girder joists. And there are actually still slight distance between the metal decking and this little joist bearing heights here, because your joists actually have a certain value to sit on top of the girder itself. So that connection point, okay, this little component of the joists, this is going to be having certain heights there. And typically this is regulated, okay, I'm talking about this particular portion here. Okay, so this portion is actually regulated by the Steel Joists Institute. A value will be specified for different sizes of open web joists. For 22K7, this value typically is actually going to be 2.5 inch. Okay, so that's the value typically is given for this little component of the open web joists. So what other dimensions do we need actually is going to be the distance between the roof and the adjacent walls. So let's go to a different view here. Okay, so this is going to be the side pilaster, and also you can use this as a guidance about the roof distance from the side wall as well. As we see here, the roof stops at on the interior face of the CMU blocks. The CMU blocks is actually, okay, the its face actually it sits right on the grid line 1 and 12 on the other side. So literally the roof stops, okay, at the CMU block width away from grid line 112. It depends on which unit you're at. If you're at unit A, you're actually 7/5/8 inch away from grid line 1. If you are at unit C, then you are 7/5/8 inch away from grid line 12. So this is 8 inch CMU block, but the actual size of the CMU blocks is actually 7/5/8 inch. Okay, so keep that in mind. Now, let's go to the next page here, okay? And here you'll see where the roof is gonna stop to the back of the wall, to the back of the building. And you see there is actually, okay, the roof stops right on the grid line, okay? Grid line C and D. For grid line C, that's for unit A and C. And for grid line D, is actually for unit B. So your roof is gonna stop at grid line C for unit A and B roof, and it's gonna stop at grid line D for unit B. Okay, so again, this little value here, okay, this little distance here, is going to be 2.5 inch. Okay, so those are the information we need in order to place the roof. The back side of the roof is 14 foot 8 inch above finished floor, and with this little distance there. Okay. The roof itself have three components. Again, it's the metal studs, the insulation, and the membrane, TPO membrane. Okay, so with this information, we're now ready to place the roof. So let's go to our 14/8 because that's the lowest point of the roof. It's kind of easier to manipulate on this view. So what I'm trying to demonstrate here is going trying to create the roof for unit A. So we go to our architecture tab and go to our roof command on the building panel, and choose the first option here, which is called roof by footprint. Okay. So roof by footprint is actually going to be allow you to select that roof type you need. In this case, we do not have any roof types we can use immediately. In this case, we have to customize it. So I choose the generic, okay, 9-inch roof and I click on edit type. And what we're going to do is actually to duplicate. Remember, always duplicate before you actually make any modification to the existing Revit family. So I call that, okay, TPO single ply, okay, and click on OK. Now, we need to actually customize the structure of the roof itself. At this moment, click on the edit structure, and you only have one layer, which is not enough. We at least have three layers, okay, two. Move the two other layers above the core boundary, okay? And obviously, the first boundary, it's a membrane, but remember in Revit, it would not allow any thickness assigned to the membrane. In this case, membrane is the outermost layer, so literally, it is actually one type of finish. So in that case, I'll just change that to finish too, and specify its thickness is gonna be, okay, 45 mm, literally, so it's, okay, so that's going to be that thickness, okay, so it's going to be 45 thousand inches, okay, so the structure, the second layer is going to be insulation, so that's going to be thermal air layer, so then it's 3 inches, right, okay, now, the structure, the real structure is actually going to be the metal studs, the metal decking. So we need to change that to 1.5 inch. Okay. Now, we have to also specify the different materials for the roof. So first thing is membrane. So let's go ahead and go to the material library. And we can search for TPO. And obviously, we do not have TPO available. So things in this case, I just tap plastic, okay? So literally, you can use any plastic at this moment, just trying to use it as, you know, a place mark for a certain material. Or if you want it so much, you can actually customize your own material and you can create a new material, okay? Call that TPO. We can actually totally do that. So you can just call that, says, right click and click on edit, and we change its name to TPO, okay. The problem with this is actually it does not have any particular, thermal properties available compared with the other materials. However, you can actually change its color to use a whitish color, Okay, and you can also change its appearance if you would like to change your appearance by going to be a plane. Okay, and you're going to change its color to a whitish color. Okay, and now you can also assign a specific image by going to image library if you have a TPA, TPO image. In this case, we just leave the way it is. That is fine. Okay, so that customizes this material here. Okay, so click on that and click on OK. And now the thermal air layer is going to be the rigid insulation. So click on that little assign by category, type rigid insulation. Okay, you'll find that rigid insulation right there. Click on OK, and the last, the structure components is going to be the metal stud. So you can just type stud, and you'll find metal stud layer right there. Okay. So if you want to connect, click on OK and finish up, and you will probably receive a message that says row 1 face layer must be have a thickness because 3/6 to 4 inches is really not recognizable by the program. So it actually kind of forces you, okay, to increase the thickness of the membrane, which is kind of interesting. So in this case, you can totally change that thickness to another thickness that is recognizable by Revit. In this case, we can use this value. Okay, so just in case, well, the actual thickness of this at this moment here doesn't really matter because you're going to use the real material anyway. So that's fine. We just use this value anyway. Okay, so in this case, you're looking at a pretty much 5-inch thick of the roof itself, and let's click on OK and finish up this roof. That's going to be your roof, okay? It's going to be TPO single ply roof. Now, with this being specified, what I also want to do is actually want to use the okay dual boundary line to define the boundary of the roof. Okay, so in this case, I'm going to draw a big box, which is the second option here, rectangle. Okay, so unit A stops at grid line C, and it goes all the way to grid line 5, if you remember that. Okay, I want you to model the lower roof all the way to the grid line, which starts to form the transition from grid, unit A to B. So that's grid line 5. So draw slightly below grid line A, because you understand that at the front, the store front, the roof actually goes 6 inches out of the beyond the grid line A. Okay, so on the side, we have to pay attention. Okay, the back is actually right on the grid line, and this side is also right on the grid line 5. But the front, okay, the front pink line has to be 6 inches, okay, away from grid line A. It's beyond grid line A. Okay, then on this side, remember it is actually 7/5/8 inch away from the grid line 1, because it's 1 CMU block away from the grid line. Okay, so in this case, you drag that line a little bit to its side. Okay, and then you specify this distance to be 7/5/8 inch. That will give you the right okay layout of your roof. Now, the big challenge here is how do you specify the slope? As you see here, those pink triangles actually are currently specifying the slope, and on all the four directions you have a slope, which is not the case in our project. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to highlight one of my pink lines and hit Tab key to select them all of the pink lines at one time. Then I'm going to uncheck define slope. Okay, so I'm not going to use the define slope tool to define the slope of the roof. Instead, I'm going to use a slope arrow. So click on the slope arrow, and the first click is going to be on the front pink line. Make sure that it's on the pink line. It goes all the way down. Okay, it has to be perpendicularly pointing to the back of the pink line, and actually sits on the pink line itself. Okay. Now, the exact location of the arrow in terms of its relationship to the side pink lines doesn't really matter. As long as it touches the front and the back pink line, that should be okay. Now, what we want to do is specify by clicking this slope arrow and specify its height and the tail to be, okay, the level of tail is going to be, okay, again, this is the tail. This is the head. The level of the tail is going to be the front, so it's going to be taller. It's going to be 16.4, okay? And the level head is actually going to be 14.8. Remember that distance, okay? You have that 2.5 inch, okay, of offsets where you have the steel joists, okay? Same here is going to be, okay? In class, we mentioned that we needed to take into account the self-thickness of the roof. Well, actually, because roof is an architecture component, it's not a structure component, so it actually goes up automatically. So in that case, that 5-inch offsets is actually kind of wrong. So please go back to your roof and make the changes accordingly to correct them. Okay? So in this case, this will be the correct dimensions of offsets and the specifications of the tail and head elevations. Okay, with that being done, let's click on the green check mark. All right, and let's take a look at the 3D view. Okay, so this will be your rule for unit A. Okay, so let's go to the left side view by clicking on the left side of the cube here and examine, and it sits, okay, as you see here, it sits right above that metal the joists, and I leave that 2.5 inch joists here to sit on top of the column on the girders, okay, so that will leave enough space to do that. All right, okay, so in this case, all right, we're actually done with unit A roof. For unit B roof and a C roof, follow the same exact methodology. The only difference here is for unit B, okay, the offset is different because the longer, the offset is longer only that 2.5 inch of the girder, the joist sitting, but also, you know, unit B roof is 5 inches taller than the rest of the roof. So your offsets, okay, and talk about this arrow here, the slope arrow offset is supposed to be 7.5 inch, 7.5 inch, okay? So that's the difference there, okay? Oh, I'll take that back. It's actually 7.5 inch at the tail and only 2.5 inch at the back because your level at head is still, at the back is still is 14.8 inches. So that offset's not going to be changed. It's only the offsets at the front of your wall, of your roof is going to be 7.5 inch. Okay, so click on that check mark and that finish up the roof itself. All right, so that actually concludes the cranium roof section. In the next video, we're going to wrap it up and actually discuss about how we actually can generate documentation from Revit models by using the sheets function in Revit.